Good morning. We're so glad you decided to join us as we worship our Lord together. We know that even though we cannot meet face to face right now, that we're connected through the Holy Spirit and united through the love of Christ. As we prepare our hearts for worship, let us turn to Psalm 104. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, wrapped in light as with a garment. You stretch out the heavens like a tent. You set the beams of your chambers on the waters. You make the clouds your chariot. You ride on the wings of the wind. You make the winds your messengers, fire and flames your ministers. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Please join me as we affirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
First reading is 1 Corinthians 6, 12 through 20. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, the two shall be one flesh. But anyone united to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The second reading is John 1, 43 through 51. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under a fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God descending, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man."
Amid all of the trouble that is Washington, D.C., articles of impeachment, a divided House and Senate, COVID relief packages, security for next week's inauguration, amid all of this, President-elect Biden is working to fill his cabinet for the executive branch. And I suppose that to be on any presidential team, one must need experience, a solid education, perhaps a measure of specialization for a position. Increasingly, one's gender or race may either qualify you or disqualify you for a seat in the halls of power. Whatever the case may be, we can certainly say that each candidate nominated by the incoming Biden administration has been discussed and vetted ad nauseum before they reach their confirmation hearings. Other presidents, President Lincoln, for example, he surrounded himself with people who didn't necessarily agree with him. This is the basis for Doris Kearn Goodwin's book called The Team of Rivals. During the Second World War, British Prime Minister Winston Churchill flanked himself with men who because of the English class system, were often old friends. They went to the same schools. They belonged to the same clubs, and because of their august pedigree, were probably related somehow. Well, in our gospel lesson this morning from the first chapter of John, our gospel reading, if we're to be imaginative, we might title it Jesus Picks His Cabinet. And here in the last section of chapter 1, we read of how at least four of the 12 disciples were chosen or came to faith. Verse 35, the next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come and see." And they came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. What we have here are two men, followers of John the Baptist, two men, one of whom we're told is Andrew. We're not given the name of the other fellow, but the overwhelming consensus from the church and from scholars is that the anonymous disciple is none other than John the Apostle, the writer of this gospel. The Apostle John never refers to himself in this his eponymous gospel, and it's very reasonable to say that it was in fact him. Andrew, John tells us, after spending time with our Lord, rushes out to tell his brother, Simon Peter. He rushes out to tell Simon Peter the news about the Messiah. Peter, who would later become the de facto leader of Christ's followers. Verse 42 tells us that he, meaning Andrew, brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated as Peter. Well, in the remaining 9 verses of this chapter, we read that the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." And what was Nathanael's response? "Oh, sounds good. Count me in." No, in what I imagine is the wryest of tones, Nathanael asks, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Right, and I'm sure the Holy Spirit lives in Wayne County. Now, what is interesting about these accounts, what is so peculiar about these events, is that what we have here right from the start of Christ's public ministry, right from the start, we're presented with different methods of coming to faith. We see that there's no set pattern of salvation, no formula in following Christ. There's not a one-size-fits-all standard for becoming a Christian. In fact, the commonality of the men we read about today, the commonality was that they were so common. Christ chooses ordinary people, painfully ordinary. Well, now we shouldn't assume that the disciples were penniless, barely educated outcasts. No, and for reasons I won't get into, we might safely say that most of the 12 had at least a rudimentary education. Some, like Peter, were business owners. That's very good evidence to say that during Christ's three-year ministry that Peter's fishing operation was run by his managers and employees. We have names like Andrew and Thaddeus and Philip. They're all Greek names. This implies a level of education possessed in the respective households. Again, we might not call these men ignorant or destitute, but also we must not see these characters as highly exalted or naturally holy. The great danger for you and me is to think of the apostles as people that were so spiritually removed from our existence that we can never, ever come anywhere close to emulating them. No, we say these men were so devoted to our Lord that they simply ignored the real world and they remained cloistered with Jesus and with each other for years. And being that each of us have families to look after, jobs to perform, our own set of problems, we think that we can never be anywhere close to the spiritual lives of these individuals. We think that they're so spiritually enlightened that the disciples understood or processed everything their master taught. Well, now it is true that Nathanael, although a follower of Christ, he wasn't part of the 12 disciples, but nonetheless, I think it's of great encouragement to know that the men we meet today, John, Peter, Nathanael, Andrew, and Philip, it's of great encouragement to know that, like the rest of the 12, these men started out as ordinary men, living out probably unexciting lives. Moreover, for those who believe that the apostles were theological geniuses, we should know that throughout our four Gospels, the disciples, they're always getting things wrong. Misunderstanding, getting things wrong, they're often petty and squabbling, they're not able to process everything all at once. This is to say that Jesus Christ, God incarnate, Savior of the world, that Jesus Christ fills his cabinet with people like you and me. Now, as we've already mentioned, the other great encouragement is the various ways that these men come to faith. That there's no prescribed method for experiencing Jesus Christ. Well, hold on just a moment. You say, what about Methodism? Surely there's a contradiction between that. Well, first off, John Wesley and his gang didn't choose the name Methodist. It was foisted upon them, as it were, as a sort of pejorative. Some people call them the supererogation men or sacramentalists, enthusiasts. Or my favorite, Bible moss. So really, Methodist doesn't really seem that bad. But the Methodist sobriquet was only given because of the methodical way in which they carried out their Christian faith. It had a sort of a regiment or a discipline to it. I think we'd do well to revive that aspect. But Methodism has nothing to do with a set method or formula for salvation. And of course, men like John and Charles Wesley would have known this from reading accounts like we find here in John chapter 1. Think about it. Here's our first example, the case of Andrew and John the Apostle. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come and see." So here's a demonstration of how Andrew and John are being shown the Christ. It was John the Baptist who says, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." He points to Jesus. And so Andrew and John the Apostle, they follow Jesus. They spend time with him. They listen to him preach. Now, this is a very common pattern for men and women today and throughout history. Perhaps a friend sees one of us struggling and says, "Look, if you want to find redemption, if you want to find forgiveness and healing and reconciliation, then I could show you Jesus in the pages of the Bible. I could point you to a place where the Word of God is taught, where it's exposed and expounded through faithful preaching. And oftentimes a person does this, and after being told that Jesus Christ is Savior, and after hearing the teachings, they arrive at the beginnings of faith. Now, I say beginnings because that's what it is. We all have to start from somewhere. Currently, I'm in the first stages of mapping out a new teaching series for Pentecost, where we look to our Bibles to understand what it means to be baptized by the Holy Spirit, what it means to live in God's fullness. Well, we know that, for example, what we have here with Andrew and John, we know that these two pious individuals, like the rest of those who were following Jesus, that they did not receive the Holy Spirit until that singular day of Pentecost. And that was 3 years after the events here in John chapter 1. Again, this is very much good news for us, that a man or a woman could come to faith in Jesus Christ, and through the regular listening and reading, fellowship and praise, those things that mark us as Christians, that a man or a woman could come to faith in Christ and be assured of the gift of the Holy Spirit, and be assured of the fullness of God, that this gift is pledged to us by our Lord. Well, now we turn to verse 43, where we're presented with Philip. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Notice that there's not much detail in this. Jesus calls Philip. Philip instantly recognizes that he is, in fact, the Messiah, and then he follows. Simple as that. We don't know anything about Philip, what he was doing, what his background was, apart that he came from Bethsaida. No, it was just like, in an instant, Philip came to faith. And this shows another pattern, that oftentimes Christ comes to us. Oftentimes it's the voice of the Lord who calls us, who convicts us, who awakens us to his presence. And where, just like Philip, we immediately know who Christ is. For those who were in our last Bible study, which unfortunately was cut short, we were going through the Alpha Course. And I think in the second or third talk, the presenter, Nikki Gumbel, use this train analogy to explain what we're talking about. And he imagined us to imagine that we were on a train and our final destination was, I think, Germany. And you're going along this rail journey, and when you cross the German border, some will know it. Some will be waiting for it. Maybe they'll clap or congratulate each other. Well, others will be maybe dozing off or reading the newspaper, and they won't know until well after they're in Germany that they're finally in Germany. And it's like coming to faith in Jesus Christ. It may be a momentous occasion, or it may be that we've crossed the border miles ago, but we never really noticed until now. However, we experience this. The point is that we've arrived. It's not how did we get there, it's that we're there. You see, the Spirit of God works in various but still amazing ways. When we say things like, because I came to faith this way, that it must be the same for you, when we argue for the one-size-fits-all salvation, then what we're doing is denying the freedom of the Holy Spirit. And so don't ever be discouraged about how you became a Christian, whether it's a bolt of lightning like Philip experiences, or whether it's through spending time with our Lord, with listening to our Lord like Andrew and John experienced. The point is that we are here, not how did we get here. Now, we've been pointing out some of the ways that these two accounts differ from one another, but now let us look on how what they have in common. And the first thing we might say is each had an experiential element to it. Each person encounters Jesus. Once again, we will invoke John Wesley. Two events really mark Wesley's spiritual life. One was on New Year's Day of 1739 at Fetter Lane in London. That's when John and Charles Wesley and George Whitfield and like 50 other people were praying through the night, and they all were baptized by the Holy Spirit. Now, we're not going to concern ourselves with that event at the present time. The other happened to Wesley 7 months prior at a Moravian meeting in the Aldersgate section of London. And while listening to the preacher, Wesley famously confessed to his diary that, "I felt my heart strangely warmed." You see, Wesley was experiencing the Spirit of God, just like Andrew and John and Philip. But he continues, I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given to me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. You see, this experience was indeed heartfelt, but we mustn't only rely on our emotions. Wesley follows up the comment that his heart was strangely warmed with the intellectual underpinnings of faith. We know that faith is not predicated on how we feel. No, faith is how we feel in relation to what we know. Wesley felt his heart strangely warm because God provided the knowledge that an assurance was given to me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. Well, now we look at our text this morning in verse 41. He, meaning Andrew, found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah." Why was Andrew so eager to tell about the Messiah? Not only because he felt the presence of God, but he had also found the Messiah. It was in Scripture. Why was Philip so eager to tell Nathanael about Jesus? Verse 45, Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." You see, in both instances, there's a theological or perhaps a teaching element to faith. They experience Jesus Christ, but they also understand who Jesus is. He's the Messiah, he whom about Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote. And if you find yourself struggling with doubt, feeling like maybe you're not a Christian, I tell you, you don't have to wait for the bolt of lightning conversion, although that's extremely possible. If you're struggling with faith, I encourage you to spend time with Jesus, spend time in worship, in fellowship, in prayer, and especially discover Jesus Christ in the pages of Scripture. Read John's Gospel. I think it takes you 2 hours, start to finish. Pray to the Lord. Ask the Lord to reveal himself to you. Approach the Bible with an open mind and see if Jesus is, in fact, he about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote. I'd like to end this morning with a question for each of you, and that is, do you have faith in Jesus Christ? Now, I'm not asking you if you've been baptized by the Holy Spirit. I'm not asking you if you read the Bible from cover to cover and understand it completely. I'm not asking if you have all the answers. All I'm asking is if at some point your heart was strangely warmed, however that may manifest itself. I'm asking you, have you come to the knowledge that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, who, because of his atoning death, because of his glorious resurrection, that Jesus Christ has taken away your sin, even yours, and saved you from the law of sin and death? This do you believe? Have you the beginnings of faith? Have you begun to understand that Jesus Christ is the answer to it all? That you're not the answer, but that he is? And if you're not completely certain that you're on the right path and receiving the fullness of God, then here's the test. Do you want to tell others about Christ? Again, I'm not asking if you have told others about Christ. I'm not asking you how many people you have spoken to, how successful or unsuccessful your words were. I'm not asking you if you know how to evangelize. I'm simply asking you this question. Do you have the desire to tell others about Jesus Christ? Have you ever read the Bible saying praises to God? Have you ever listened to a man preach and thought, I wish that he or she were here to experience this? Have you ever asked God that someone you love, that they could feel the same love that God gives us? Do you desperately want someone to come and see the Lord Jesus Christ? You see, the thing that connects our stories together is that they all wanted to tell others. The first thing that Andrew does after meeting Christ, the first thing Andrew does is tell Simon Peter, "We have found the Messiah." And then Andrew brought Simon Peter to Jesus. Philip, upon being called by Jesus, Philip goes and tells Nathanael that we have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth. You see, the thing that marks us as Christians is that we have a deep and heartfelt desires to tell others about Christ. Philip tells Nathanael, and Nathanael challenges him. How could anything good come out of Nazareth? And like Philip, we also will be met with doubt and skepticism when we tell others about Christ. But look what we could learn from Philip. When Nathanael doubts the authenticity of what's being said, Philip doesn't go into a theological lecture. He doesn't argue Aquinas' proof for God. Philip doesn't grab a scroll and present a Bible study. No, this is Philip's response. Verse 46, Philip said to him, come and see. Notice that Philip can't answer Nathanael's question. And he doesn't have to right now. You see, it could be as simple as come and see for yourself. We don't need all of the explanations right yet. Christ will resolve all of our problems and answer all of our questions in time. We only need to know him more, to understand more. Let me summarize with three questions about Jesus. Do you know enough about him? Have you ever experienced him? And do you want the whole world to know this? Is it your great desire to bring everyone to him? Do you long for the day when every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord? If you do, then it is my privilege to bestow upon you the assurance that you are on the pathway to righteousness. Now, more is always needed. Study and fellowship, participation, prayer and reading. But if you can say that you know who Christ is, that Christ has touched you, and that you want everyone to come and see, if you're certain of this, then it doesn't matter how you got here. It matters only that you are here. And from these simple beginnings, Jesus Christ leads us to the baptism of the Holy Ghost and the receiving of his fullness. And that, dear friends, is such a joy unspeakable. Amen.
My reward and all of my
We'd like to thank you for being part of our worship service today, and I want to remind you that as a church, we continue to discern where God is leading us, especially through these strange times. Please continue to pray for our church, for our families and communities, and continue to pray for one another. Now for a word of blessing. Go in the name of Jesus our Christ, who, without saying where he was going, said, "Follow me." And the peace of God, which we cannot fully understand, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you forever. Amen.